In 2016, 53 people committed suicide and 198 people attempted it in Thurston County alone. It is the eighth leading cause of death in our county and affects our entire community. I'm Commissioner John Hutchings, and today I'm speaking with the coroner, a child adolescent psychiatrist with behavioral health resources, a 911 dispatcher, and leaders with the Thurston Mason Behavioral Health Organization and Public Health and Social Services. And we're talking about suicide, awareness, and prevention. Together, we are the answer. It is on us to be the first to reach out, the first to talk to someone about suicide, and to provide resources, and the first to do the follow-up. Have you ever been so full of despair that the word depression doesn't quite describe your feeling? Despair so bleak that it's like someone has taken the earth, pulled the plug out of the bottom, and all the color has run out? On this episode of Thurston County Connection, we dig into the topic of suicide. Phone numbers will continually scroll at the bottom of the screen throughout this episode. First, I'll be speaking with Emily Maxwell, a dispatcher with Thurston 911 Communications. More than 990 people call 911 annually saying they're thinking about committing suicide.
911, what are you reporting?
I just don't even know if I want to live anymore.
Okay.
I got... This County AIDS Foundation is me over, and they won't even help me with housing assistance, and I just can't handle this anymore.
Okay, what address are you at?
I am here with Emily Maxwell, and Emily is a TCOM 911 dispatch supervisor, and she has graciously taken her time before work today to come in and talk with us about this topic, suicide. Emily, I understand you've been with TCOM how many years?
For 11 years.
11 years, and you're a dispatch trainer.
Yes, I'm also a trainer, yep.
And how many dispatchers do you train in a year?
It just depends on the year, but usually I would say 2 to 5.
Okay. I'm sure glad there's people still applying for that job.
Yes.
In this volatile era that we have. What's it like to receive a call where someone is so despondent that they're suicidal?
It can be pretty scary, and you have to try to find a way to connect with that caller and calm that caller, but at the same time, you're concerned about the safety for your responders too, so you need to get a location quickly and, find out if they have any means to harm themselves.
Any weapons.
Any weapons, mm-hmm. And make sure that they're going to be cooperative with responders.
So, yeah, and responders is fire and law enforcement.
Yes, it can be fire and law enforcement. Sometimes it can be both, sometimes one or the other, just depending on the circumstances.
And sometimes I know this for a fact because of my professional background, that it could be 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, everything's quiet in the dispatch center, and then that call comes in.
Yep, absolutely.
And it wakes you up, your adrenaline starts pumping right away.
Mm-hmm.
Does another dispatcher come over to help you out, or do you take the call and you go through protocol? What is it you do?
Well, we all do work as a team. Usually you'll have someone taking the call and then a dispatcher that's dispatching law enforcement and another dispatcher that's dispatching the fire department. If you have any additional concerns, other dispatchers might help you with maybe some questions that maybe you forgot to ask or didn't think to ask, and we all work together as a team.
So you are thinking of questions to ask, and another dispatcher might be feeding you questions.
Sure.
You have law enforcement and fire personnel asking you questions
exactly.
So it's very dynamic, and you're still trying to establish a relationship and calm the caller.
Yes. Yeah, and that actually can be a pretty difficult balance, especially at the beginning of a call, because you want to get as much information for the responders as possible to make sure that everyone's going to stay safe, including the callers and the responders. And you don't want to minimize the caller's concerns, you know, what the problem that they're having that mm-hmm. day, but it's very important that you get that information for the responders.
Yeah, and I don't want to call them first responders because predominantly you are the first responder.
Yeah, we take that first
call.
You
really are.
Yeah.
And I know after decades working in law enforcement, you're the last one to find out what happened.
Yeah, a lot of times we don't find out what happens. You know, we'll see that law enforcement gets on scene and they may get transported somewhere, and that's it for us. That's all that we find out.
Now, I know you don't have hard numbers and data, and that we don't need to get into that at all. I just want to ask the types of 911 calls where someone's where it's a suicide attempt versus a completed suicide. Are they 50-50?
Oh, no, it's much. Maybe a little exaggerated, but probably 100-1. We probably get many more attempted or even just thinking about committing suicide, and they call us, or a friend or family member will call us and say that they're worried about, and that's actually probably the majority calls that we get is a friend or family member concerned about their loved one and wanting us to go check on them. But yeah, it's, I would say more so we're helping them.
And what's kind of unique, and I really like this, is someone will call 911 anywhere in the country wanting someone in Olympia or Lacey or Tumwater or in Thurston County
yep.
to check on a loved one. And you get the call then.
Yes.
And we will go out. You will send someone out.
Oh, absolutely. Yep.
That's brilliant.
Yep.
What? So when you have a call that is successfully resolved, I mean, that's got to feel good.
Absolutely, it feels good. When you know that the responders get there, whether it's the police department or fire department, and you see that patient or person getting transported to the hospital to receive the help that they need, it does make you feel like you've made a difference with them.
I mean, you're right there at that critical
yeah.
point in someone's life. Almost like when you're talking with, you're delivering a baby.
Yeah.
I mean, you talk about
yes.
critical stress right
yeah,
there.
Yeah, you're very concerned about what you're saying. You know, if you ask them, you know, mm-hmm. is there anyone there that, you know, that you could speak to or that cares about you, and they tell you that they don't have anyone that cares about them, it's hard to hear, and you don't want to make them feel worse than they already feel. You were there to try to make them feel better.
So is it difficult to separate yourself and keep that professional rather than become emotionally involved in the call or with the caller?
I think with training and years of experience, I've been able to do that okay. We have to do that with all types of calls, so.
Well, I would imagine,
yeah.
Even like teaching someone or having a child do CPR on
yep.
a parent or someone. So it would be more difficult, you think, for newer dispatchers?
Yes, it can be more difficult for newer dispatchers.
And because I would imagine you experienced that with your training and
sure.
such.
Sure, yep.
What kind of protocol, what kind of training does a dispatcher receive
regarding
this type of call?
Yes, you start out at TCOM, you start out with call receiving training, and it's about a 5-week course. And in that 5-week course, you may be lucky to get one full day of training on suicidal calls, suicide prevention. And then throughout like my 11 years there, I've probably had maybe 3 different classes that I've been able to lucky enough to attend that are about 8 hours long, which isn't a lot of training. Honestly, probably the best training I have is listening to other call takers in the room, how they've handled it, their experiences, listening to their successes and their failures is definitely a great learning tool to be able to handle these kinds of calls.
Is TCOM hiring now?
We just hired a class. I'm sure we'll be hiring again within the next few months.
So I would throw this out to anybody watching that if you're interested in being involved in some type of a profession where you can really make a difference in someone's life and feel good about it, I would say dispatch is right there.
Yeah, absolutely. That's why I do. That's why I do this job.
I want to ask you two things about an experience you may have had with a caller, but also the impact on dispatch as a whole when a suicide call doesn't go exactly as you would expect it to or want it to go.
Well, sure. I've personally taken a call, well, many calls, but I do remember one incident where a young man called and he felt that he had nothing left in life at all. He didn't have any family that cared about him. Well, he thought he didn't have any family that cared about him. He'd lost his job, he'd lost his place to live, and that was it. He didn't know what else to do, and he thought that taking his life was the answer. And, you know, I just stayed on the phone with him, tried to find some common ground with him, let him know that, you know, I'm here and that I care, and that the reason why I do this job is to help people and to help save lives. And I was able to keep him on the line until help could get there. And to me, that's a success.
That is a huge success. Yeah. And I'm not going to ask you for any other call, but I don't want to share that. But I would imagine it's a huge negative, very traumatic, just the way the impact on dispatchers
absolutely
it doesn't go the way you want.
I've walked into the room after a very serious suicide call that happened maybe, you know, 10 minutes before I got there. Mm-hmm. And you can feel the tension in the room. You can feel the sadness in the room, and it is difficult, but you know, we're all there for each other. We understand that some people might have a harder time dealing with a call than others. We'll give each other a break to, you know, if they need an extra 20 minutes to relax, if they need to go home, and you know, or just someone to talk to. We're always there to talk with each other.
Well, and you don't know what's going on in the dispatcher's personal life or what kind of experiences they've had with a loved one,
right,
or a friend either, and that's got to have a huge impact. Later in the segment, we're going to be talking with a panel of experts in this field, and we're going to be talking about collective impact. That's why I asked about the impact within dispatch, because there's a collective community impact as well. Emily, I thank you so much. You're exceedingly kind to come in and share with us your profession and the love and kindness and concern for all dispatchers.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
I'm here with Joe Avalos from the Thurston Mason Behavioral Health Organization, Liz Davis from Public Health and Social Services, Gary Warnock, our Thurston County Coroner, and Dr. Linda Young, a child and adolescent psychiatrist with Behavioral Health Resources. Thank you all for being here and taking time out of your busy day to do this panel with me and impart some vital information. And so with that, I think as maybe the starting point, I'll ask you, Liz, about data collection that you have regarding youth.
We are experiencing a mental health crisis for youth in Thurston County. Every year, kids are administered a survey in school, and it's called the Healthy Youth Survey. It measures anonymously their responses to questions that have to do with all aspects of their health. And one of the questions that they're asked about is depression. And we start looking at eighth graders when we're talking about depression, and one in three eighth graders right now are saying that they feel depressed. Nearly 40% of our high school students are saying they are experiencing depression. If you look just at girls, that rises to half. And if you look just at low income kids, that goes all the way up to 2/3. In addition, anxiety is a huge problem. 2 out of 3 kids who are in high school say that they experience anxiety more than several times a week. And when you look just at girls, that goes up to 75%. And then, unfortunately, our statistics about suicide attempts and considering suicide are really, really out of control. 1 in 5 high school students in Thurston County say that they've seriously considered suicide. 1 in 3 girls. And when you're looking at disparities with low-income students, nearly half of our low-income high school students say that they've seriously considered suicide.
That is shocking and very sad. So with that in mind, we just had in the news recently, it's been reported, that Tahoma High School up in, I believe, Marysville or Mount Lake, I can't forget the city right now, had a cluster of suicides. One young person in August of 2017, and then two within the last couple of weeks. Can anybody, who would like to talk about the clusters or the kind of a grouping of suicides like that, which is unusual? I think it's unusual.
It is. I don't think I've seen that here in Thurston County as far as any groupings with a local high school where there's been several from one location.
I've definitely seen it in another place where I lived, where we had suicide of a popular person in the school, and then a follow-up group of suicides and suicide attempts, despite the outreach of several mental health professionals. And it can be very scary. It's also scary for the professionals in the school, the teachers, the mental health counselors in the school. And, you know, I think that that's one of the reasons a lot of people have been very concerned about the popular TV program, 13 Reasons Why, and how that's affected a lot of youth. And there's actually research going on as to how that has affected youth and whether there's been an increase in suicide ideations and suicides with that program.
And within the last week, I heard on the news being reported that social media plays a huge factor in youth suicide as well, mm-hmm. With the obvious bullying, but also exposure and regret of things that are being said about somebody else or things that may have been put on another social media that causes someone to commit suicide or kill themselves. We can do an entire different show on just sympathizing, sympathizer or copycat or whatever. Mm-hmm. How what is that called? Is it called a sympathizer, and is it, to help me out now because I don't know where I'm going with that.
Well, there's several terms, but copycat suicides is definitely a term that is frequently used.
Okay. So let's talk about, since we're talking about youth, but it's also is all ages, the myths and or the stereotypes surrounding the topic of suicide.
May I?
Yeah, please chime in.
It's not really discussed in our community. The only time you really hear about a suicide, if it's done in a local arena, if it's a public event, that's when you hear about it. But generally the suicides that we see here in Thurston County, they're behind closed doors, and the community doesn't hear about that.
That's an interesting concept that we don't hear about those unless it's sensationalized in the media.
And if the media gets a hold of a suspicious death in a neighborhood and it's determined to be a suicide, there's no story on it.
Wow. There's a myth, and I don't want to get too far from the kids yet because I want to ask about the range of suicide that there has been or that we've experienced in our community. But also, when I'm talking about the stereotype, like it's just... someone might say, well, that's just a kid acting up, looking for, it's a cry for help. And it may not be that. Or the myth that, I'm afraid to talk to my friend about suicide because if I ask him if they're going to kill themselves, I might put the idea in their head, which is absolutely wrong. It's a myth. So
absolutely.
What kind of age range are we looking at in total? And then let's talk about the myth real quick.
At this point, I don't think that it's ever too early. You know, I definitely have different ways of asking the question. If I'm talking to a really young child who I feel like is feeling very hopeless and helpless and despondent, I will be very careful on how I ask the question. I may ask the question, have things ever gotten so bad that you felt like that you might not want to live anymore, instead of using the word, do you want to kill yourself or are you thinking about suicide? But as the child gets older, especially in the teen years, I'm not hesitant at all for someone that is depressed to ask them, are you thinking about hurting yourself? Are you thinking about committing suicide? Have you ever hurt yourself? Are you setting up a plan? I'm very direct with them, and I do not feel in any form or manner that that actually plants the seed, because right. I find in most cases where they're depressed that they have actually had some thoughts already.
And before anybody else answers that question, I just want to point out to the guests, or the audience at home rather, that Dr. Linda Young, you are a board certified child psychiatrist, correct?
Yes, I am.
And isn't there only about 3,000 of you in the United States?
That's correct, and the number is decreasing.
Right, and so we are exceedingly benefited by having you working in this community.
Well, thank you.
Greatly appreciate that, and it shouldn't be missed on anybody. You're a wealth of information.
And it's my honor to work here.
So, thank you. Anybody else about the myth of suicide or stereotyping?
You know, I think the University of Washington has a great acronym called LEARN. And it stands for, well, the first one is look for signs. And I think Dr. Young talked about what some of those signs are. And you know, the more of us that pay attention to things that go unsaid, I think we can all do better at paying attention, right? So that's the first one, look, L. E stands for empathize. And this is just listening. It's listening without judgment. It's listening without asking why are you having feelings about this. Most people who have survived suicide attempts talk about the thing that was most helpful for them was when somebody listened, not when somebody judged. The A, I'll have to look now what the A is for, I forget.
And while you're looking that up, I read something at the end of I believe it was State Department of Health, and they had something very similar to that, Joe, and it was advocating be the first to reach out to a friend, be the first to talk about it, be the first to provide resources to that individual, and be the first to follow up with that individual as well. Don't anybody fall through the cracks. And oftentimes people are concerned, I feel awkward, but I'm not going to talk about it. But as soon as somebody does kill themselves, most people that know that individual, I should have done something. Mm-hmm. And then that guilt, remorse feel, you know, kicks in. So be the first to do that. So go ahead with A.
Okay, so L, look for signs. E, empathize. A, ask about suicide. And it's okay to ask that direct question, as you said, are you having feelings of suicide? And be prepared for a yes. And know what to do next. Know what some of the resources are in your region. And then R stands for reduce the danger. And so this is asking somebody if they actually have the means of carrying this out. Mm-hmm. Do they have access to weapons or medications? And if they do, if you're a person that is, if you're a parent or a guardian, you know, make sure to, you know, remove those their means to the degree that you can. Mm-hmm. And then N, which is I think the most important, is the next steps. Never leave the person alone. And think about ways that you can look for help. And I think here in this county, we do have quite a bit of resources available. And one of them is called the System of Care Hub. And the website is systemofcare.com. And it is a local collaborative of behavioral health treatment agencies in the community. So this is community youth services. This is Catholic Community Services, behavioral health resources. And someone can go on that website and punch in, I need help with depression, or I need help with suicide prevention, I need help with anxiety. And it will give a link to agencies that are local that can help with any of those issues. We also, in Thurston County, just rolled out something called the Kids Mobile Crisis, or Youth Mobile Crisis. And so what that means is it's a mental health professional and a peer professional who are able to go in the community and respond to emergency room settings in the home if somebody has a mental health emergency, or if they have someone or they're with someone who thinks that or is having feelings of suicide ideation. And so I think there are a lot of resources here locally, and that will help with some of what you were talking about. This really goes unsaid. So making sure people have access to the resources, making sure that people know where to go for help, that's really one of the most important steps in doing this. Because a lot of times when you are running into someone or somebody tells you, I'm just feeling down or feeling depressed, or I may have thoughts of suicide, the next step is, well, what do I do with that? Where do I go for help? And so getting that message out there is really key.
Which would be real tough for a young person to do, but it can be done and has been done. And so I guess the question is, how would someone, and I'm going to take it out of the realm of adults, how would a youth broach that subject with a friend? Is there an easy way to do that rather than just walk up and ask? And again, as you both pointed out, you just don't ask. You're not thinking of hurting yourself, are you? Because the answer is no. Are you thinking of killing yourself? Are you thinking of taking your own life? Being very direct, but it's difficult for someone that doesn't have that kind of confidence.
And I think too, in our schools, as we've talked about, it is a subject that is difficult to broach, and it's something that has shame associated with it in our community. And I think you'll talk a little bit about denial later, but if we're not willing to talk about it in the schools, if kids aren't in health class or with counselors being taught how to have those conversations with their peers and their friends, then it's not effective. So we need to be willing to have those conversations in the schools, not only with kids that are suffering, but with kids that want to be supportive of their friends.
Okay. Anybody else on that topic?
I find in my practice that a lot of the times the way these teenagers come to our attention is because a peer was willing to tell. And I think that happens at school a lot of the time, is that they find out among themselves that someone is suicidal and they are willing to let an adult know. And I really appreciate that because they're taking care of each other. That's awesome. And it's through social media a lot of the times that they find out. But we need to encourage the peers to tell that this is one time that you don't keep a secret. You
right.
let somebody know that your friend is in trouble.
That's profoundly important.
And it is.
I don't know if anybody here can speak to the amount of resources are available in the schools.
Mm-hmm.
Can anybody here speak to that?
Sure. So most of the schools in the Thurston County region do have some sort of mental health or substance use treatment at either in the school or near the school. We contract with about 40 different providers in the region who are able to either go to the schools or are stationed in the schools to meet with teachers, meet with students individually, and be a resource for them for either whether that's referring to an outside entity or somebody to BHR, or whether that's helping directly, just in class or during the school day.
Is that Thurston and Mason County?
This is Thurston and Mason County.
And Mason, okay,
correct.
Both.
Yes.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
Very good. I want to ask you something before I get into what you do individually, what resources you have individually. I want to ask you about community impacts. But a group that we've left out so far between just adults and youth is the veteran. And what I want to ask is, what would you tell, or how would you help, or how could you help a combat veteran who's come back, who has suffered a traumatic brain injury or a CTE, a considerable concussion, and PTSD, and he finds himself back at home, reintegrated after, you know, post-deployment, and he's back at home with his family and little kids running around, and he feels so despondent, so hopeless and helpless that he realizes at one point he has a 9mm in his mouth and he feels the metal hitting his teeth, and then he realizes the hammer's back and his finger's on the trigger, and he realizes, I don't want to do this. What's available besides the VA? What's available for that the soldier?
So that's always a tough one, of course. And I think that there are resources available. So one, if he realizes this, he can call the Crisis Clinic of Thurston and Mason Counties, and they are anonymous and confidential, and they can respond and talk through it. I think there's a Veterans Helpline as well that they can call anytime 24/7. And then finally, we have the last line of support here in Thurston County, or what are called the designated crisis responders. And so these are, in short, we call them DCRs. So these are mental health professionals who can detain someone, that is, place them in an inpatient setting involuntarily for a period of 72 hours if a person is determined to be in serious risk of hurting themselves or others, or they cannot take care of their daily activities or medical or physical activities due to a mental health or substance use disorder. And these are for persons ages 13 and up. So those are the three lines of support that are available for a veteran other than the VA, if there's that realization,
yeah,
and he can pick up the phone. For sure.
And
or
for
a family member.
Okay, what, Liz?
There's also a veterans hub in Lacey where vets can get all sorts of different services. There's case management available there, everything from counseling, behavioral health resources. You also have accessibility to housing support, all sorts of different things. And a lot of the clients that they do have experience post-traumatic stress or other types of issues after coming back home. So there are a lot of resources available for vets in our community.
And I might add that at the bottom of the screen is rolling the National Crisis Hotline and the Crisis Clinic, local Crisis Clinic Hotline, and the Veterans Crisis Hotline is also scrolling at the bottom of the screen. Because we don't want to forget our veterans, the men and women that have actually done so much for our country and come back injured. Injured. We need to take care of them. And that 22 too many a day is a powerful organization. Let's talk about community impact, whether it be a young person, an elderly person, or a veteran. What kind of community impact is there when that happens, when a suicide event occurs?
It goes back to, it depends on where it's at. If the person's well known and if it's in a private setting, the general public is never going to hear about it.
And so the private setting, would that mostly be?
The residents or?
Well, the resident, but might it be like an elderly person who's diagnosed with a
terminal illness?
A terminal illness, thank you.
Sure, the community will never hear about those. Only statistician, when at the end of the year there's our data, that's the only time it's made public.
What other kind of community impacts could there be? I know, Liz, you're with Thurston Thrives as well, which is a community initiative in so many different areas. What kind of impact would that be collectively?
Well, I would say part of the focus needs to be on prevention. And when we look at health, we're looking at the total person and everything that makes up health. And we know that clinical care is only one part of that. It's looking at housing, it's looking at our education, the food we eat, the way that our communities are designed to be able to not only support physical activity and walkability, but how do we support social connections and resiliency among people. We know that social connections are a big part of feeling a part of a community, and it's a big part of health. There are things called protective factors that are important for both children and families, to include helping parents to learn about the social emotional competence of their children and understanding what appropriate expectations for behavior are at a developmental period in their lives. We have really great resources available for kids and families in both government and nonprofit in our community. And we really have to start young in supporting children in their health, but also supporting parents who may have experienced a lot of adversity in their lives, because mm-hmm. It has to be a multi-generational approach. And if we're not looking at health as something that is cyclical and passed from one generation to the next, then we're going to continue to see problems.
Yeah, like cycle of abuse or cycle of anything else.
Exactly.
Take a whole generational change.
Because trauma tends to increase over time.
Who can speak to the signs, the warning signs?
I'll be glad to.
Doctor, thank you.
Yes. I mean, a definite warning sign, of course, is depression. Depression is the number one cause of suicide. And so any of the signs of depression, which would include a change in sleep or appetite, a decrease of energy, isolation from friends, family, a change in performance at work or school, frequent complaints of physical symptoms that are not really explained, preoccupation with death and dying, change in the
It's an all-encompassing.
It really
and people
is.
Might not pick up on it. It might be happening subtly, each of those symptoms subtly over time, and you just kind of get used to it or kind of rationalize it.
So also, we don't want to forget about drug and alcohol use, and an increase in drug and alcohol use can also be a warning sign. In our youth, running away, rebelliousness, getting into trouble with the law can be a warning sign. Pulling away from those people that really care about them.
How about drawings or notes, pictures?
Definitely. And that can be on social media, and sometimes that's elusive to those of us that care, the adults that care for them, because we're not always on Snapchat and some of the other social media that they use. A neglect in hygiene can be a sign, especially if that's a sudden change. A marked personality change can be a sign. And then, of course, just a loss of hope and a feeling of helplessness.
Those are warning signs.
Yes.
And so I would encourage everybody to be cognizant of that, if it's a loved one, close friend, or family member as well. Just be aware. And again, don't be afraid to approach that individual and ask the important question. I'm going to ask the coroner, Gary Warnock, what is it your office does? We all want to know. What is it you and your folks, your staff do?
So we are the primary death investigators for Thurston County. We determine cause and manner of death. And then we're on the topic of suicide. When we do our workups or our investigation on suicides, we ask the families these difficult questions, and it's basically, generally when you approach these families, they're in an immediate denial. There's no way that their loved one did this. There's just no way. Somebody else did it. And then when we start asking these questions, the telltale signs are there. Money issues, relationships, loss of job, mental health, lack of physician. They lost maybe their primary doctor. All of those things play a role in this. Access to firearms, doctor hit on that. Drug and alcohol abuse, all that. And then when you paint that picture, it's part of our suicide indicators at the very last paragraph of our report. And it just lists all those indicators. And it just kind of, I don't want to say it's a pretty picture, but it paints a better picture for the family to read when they can read those indicators there.
Right, but it's still, the instant shock and denial, I'm going to guess, is because they can't believe it happened, but also the stigma attached.
Sure, people don't want to talk about it. And we had a local high school student commit suicide several years ago, and the principal didn't want to acknowledge that, and he just told everybody it was under investigation, and didn't want to put that stigma with suicide on that student or the school itself.
Okay. Before we wrap this up, is there any final thoughts from the panel, something you want to get out that you want the public to hear?
You know, I think for us at the Thurston Mason BHO, I want the public to know that there are resources available. And, you know, our main function is to provide access to publicly funded behavioral health, so that's mental health or substance use treatment for primarily Medicaid and low-income individuals. But for the crisis services, that's regardless of income. That's available to anybody in Thurston and Mason counties. And
wonderful.
So they can just go to our website, tmbho.org, and there's a big red button that says crisis services, and those are available 24/7.
That's beautiful. Liz, briefly, and then Doc, briefly, what services do you offer?
Well, the Veterans Hub is one place where we have people from public health and social services providing case management. And also we do have a lot of prevention programs and community engagement programs. So just want people to know that people at public health and social services are working hard for the community to be able to do prevention programs as well as helping to deal with issues that people are already having.
Okay. Linda?
I just want to emphasize again that, you know, depression is a major cause of suicide, as is exposure to violence, and that includes domestic violence mm-hmm. or trauma of any kind in the past. Another major cause of suicide is exposure to firearms. That's something we can do something about.
Okay.
A lot of these are issues that we can do something about. Substance abuse, bullying, those are all issues that we can do something about. So a lot of these are issues that we can do something about in the community. We definitely can be more supportive of our families. And I think as a community, we can all join together and work hard to decrease the suicide rates.
And it will take substantial hard work.
Yes.
I want to thank you, each of you, Joe Avalos, Liz Davis, Gary Warnock, our coroner, and Dr. Linda Young, for being here today. And I just want to emphasize again that we can't leave our veterans out. We have to do everything we can to support our men and women. They've never turned their back on us, and nor should we turn our back on them. And as for the youth, you've probably heard this before, that our youth are 30% of our population, but they're 100% of our future. So we have to nurture them and ensure that we're providing all the services we can so they can thrive no matter where they live. So thank you all very much again for being here. I greatly appreciate it. Thanks for tuning in to Thurston County Connection on Thurston Community Media. Suicide is a tough topic to talk about, but it is so important that we do. If you or someone you know is struggling with suicide, contact the National Prevention Lifeline at 1-800-273-8255 or the local crisis clinic number 360-586-2800. If you're a veteran who is struggling with thoughts of suicide, reach out to the Veterans Crisis Line at 1-800-273-8255. But always, for emergencies, please remember to call 911.